So today's video is going to be a little bit different. I'm going to be focusing on reupholstering and cleaning these vintage couches as well as this chair. I picked them up from an auction house slash antique store that's going out of business, and I paid about half of the price that is listed on them. So I think this set was around $260 or $280, which is probably a little steep for what they are, but I really like the design of these and they're surprisingly comfortable. I've sat on a lot of vintage couches over the past year because I really want one to use as a prop in photos and to just have in my room in general, and they've all been awful to sit on, just absolutely terrible. So when I saw these and I really liked the design, I was also pleasantly surprised by how comfortable they are. So I asked the man that was working there and he was willing to sell them to me for half off. So now I have this beautiful set. They're not in the best condition. I was told they're from the Victorian era, which would be mid 1800s or late 1800s. And I'm not sure if they're that old, but I definitely don't think they're from this century. They definitely need some refinishing work. There are a couple scratches in the bigger one, like this one, and there are plenty of these underneath around the feet. The velvet on them isn't in the best shape either. Especially this one, you can tell it's very dirty and kind of dimpled. And then this one actually has some scratches in it. There's some paint marks, and this one is missing a button. If these were in better condition, I'd be happy to leave them as is, but unfortunately there are flaws that I think should be repaired. They also didn't do a very good job when they upholstered these. I definitely think the upholstery is more recent than the woodwork. So I feel okay trying to recover them, but I've never done anything like that before, so it's gonna be a little bit of an adventure, and I thought I would take you along with me. As I said, I've never done anything like this before, so I'm probably gonna make some mistakes, and I'm happy to learn from your wisdom if you have any tips for when I attempt this in the future. But please don't be too harsh because I'm gonna do the best that I can with what I have available to me. The goal for today is to get all of these cleaned and recovered. And it might be a little bit ambitious, but I'm hoping for the best. So it's gonna take a nice time lapse of me removing all of the gimp trim so I could clean right up to the edge of the fabric before removing the material and recovering this. And the recovering job they did for this, I knew it was bad just because underneath the edges are frayed and there's glue peeking out, but they didn't even remove the base layer. So I think whatever's under here is original, and then they just put this really thin velvet on top. You can actually still see some of the original trim too that has turned completely brown. I'd originally planned on removing the velvet and then vacuuming this quite heavily, and I think that layer of material might get in the way of doing that. But I imagine that is holding the shape of a lot of these pieces, so I'm not sure how easy it will be to recover without that. But I guess I will continue removing the gimp, and then I will do the cleaning and figure out how to approach that part later on. But that's kind of interesting, definitely not what I expected. So I've removed all of the gimp trim except for this front section because I just wanted to show you how drastically different the colors of this they used are. So they used one that matches on the entire perimeter of the smaller sofa, and it's this nice blue color. And then everything else they used is purple, and it's like bright purple once you get it off. So I think part of this is that it's faded over time. It's either been in the sun or something has spilled on it. I'm kind of surprised there isn't more variation in the color of the velvet if it is from the sun, but it could be that the dye quality of this is just worse than the fabric. But either way, this does not match, and I'm feeling a lot better about removing all of the trim and the material from this and redoing it. I've also discovered more of this stuff, which I'm pretty sure is original, and I believe the backs of these chairs are actually stuffed with some sort of fiber that I wasn't expecting. You can see some of the alleged fiber here just coming out, and it totally looks like spiders to me, and it's really been creeping me out, but I don't think it's spiders, and I'm gonna keep going. And hopefully we won't run into any. So I think the next step, I'm not sure if I want to clean it or remove the material. I was gonna do it while the fabric was still on so I didn't get any of the wax onto the material, but I feel like they've really gone outside the lines, so I'm not really going to be able to clean right up to the edge of the wood unless I remove the fabric first. So I think that is the next point of action. I stopped filming pretty quickly because I realized the progress was going very slowly. They used so many staples for these, and the wood is surprisingly soft, so it's very difficult to get a screwdriver underneath the staple and to get it out effectively without damaging the edge of the wood where it will be visible. So it's been very slow going just because of the quantity of work and also with how delicate you have to be when you're doing it. I also discovered for this one, they basically just recovered the bottom with more velvet of the same color. I think this got damaged, and instead of removing it, they just plastered another layer on top, and that's why the gimp around the bottom edge of this matched the fabric better. Either it was the same color, but it was newer, so it wasn't faded, or they couldn't match the other gimp, so they purchased a new color, which happened to be more accurate. Something kind of cool as I've been uncovering this are some pink threads, and this actually looks very close to the color of pink velvet that I purchased for this. So I might actually be kind of restoring it to the original color it was, which is sort of neat. So it's been a couple hours, and as you can see, it's going wonderfully. I got this chair completely stripped, so the back is done. It's kind of interesting, they've used burlap for the backing, and they've actually used straw as padding, which I'm pretty sure is an old technique. I think these days they mostly use wool fiber. And there's some wool fiber mixed in there, and it's surprisingly comfortable. So I think I'm gonna leave it as is and just wipe the sections clean, as well as vacuuming it quite thoroughly. So you can see the foam is off. These are some of the hundreds of staples that have come out of this thing. I've also started stripping this. I don't know if I mentioned it in my last clip, but they basically reupholstered over top of another layer of matching fabric, except the fabric on the bottom layer is much darker and in better condition than the top fabric. That shows how worn this top layer is. I've done some of this. More of the pink is being revealed. So this was definitely pink at some point, though it seems like the pink fabric was attached to a staple, so that might not be the original color it was. Back here, this panel is removed, but I haven't removed very many of the staples. Here, at one point, they were too lazy to remove all the staples from the first layer of material, so they just decided to extend the second layer farther, which is high quality laziness right there. And there are just so many staples in this. Not as bad down here, but once I rip off this layer, there'll be more staples underneath it, securing the original layer of fabric. And here you can really see the abundance of staples that I'm talking about. They're half inch staples, and they're stacked pretty much right on top of each other. And they're about 5 or 6 per inch. It's absolutely ridiculous. Here's the progress that has been made. The larger couch is completely uncovered. I just have to tip it over and get the rest of the fabric off, but all of these staples are out. Then for the smaller couch, all of the fabric and staples around the base are out. There are just a couple more to get out of here, as well as a couple more out of the back. And then the chair is completely done. So 2 out of 3 isn't too bad, and then the third is almost done. A few interesting things that we've come across, that this material appears to be made out of horsehair. It has almost a polyester feel to it, and there were little fibers sticking out, which I associate with horsehair. There was also originally trim going around this edge that wasn't removed prior to it being recovered, which I think is kind of ridiculous. But the trim around it suggests that this was actually the original top layer fabric, which is kind of interesting since it isn't particularly pretty or soft. I don't know if that's a very common thing, or maybe this was just a structural layer and then the trim was to bulk out the edge and make the next layer fabric go on smoother. I'm not entirely sure, but I'm probably gonna research this later. The backs are burlap, as I said earlier, and then they're padded with straw and wool. Since bits of horsehair and straw are coming out of these, I am gonna go ahead and put a layer of quilt padding over both sides, at least one layer, and hopefully that will prevent anything from coming out and poking through the velvet, and also give it a little bit more structure and volume. Which this probably needs since it's been a while since that portion has been reupholstered. The foam is obviously new. I don't know if I mentioned that earlier. There's also plywood underneath it, which is somewhat new. There's also a crossbeam there that has a relatively normal looking barcode on it. So I think this was probably spruced up and recovered sometime in the 80s or 90s. And then the last discovery that I want to mention is this, which is some of the original trim. You can also see some of the horsehair fabric here, but it's mostly been pulled away. However, there is some of that trim there, and this looks very, very old to me. So it does make me think that perhaps this could be late or even early Victorian era, but I'm gonna have to do some more research on that. I just remembered earlier when I was complaining about spiders and how it looked like insects were coming out of this while I was ripping off trim. This is what I was thinking of. So this is some of the deteriorating gimp, as well as some of the deteriorating horsehair. It just looks very insect leg-like to me. So I knew it wasn't that, but that's why it was creeping me out as I was originally removing some of the fabric and trim from this. But now that I know what it is, I feel slightly better about it, though I am kind of looking forward to removing all of it and there no longer being a trace of it. So I don't have a ton of battery left and I'm not gonna be able to film a ton, but I wanted to show you guys what a difference this dust makes. This is not an ad because no one wants to pay me to promote things, but this is what I'm gonna be using. And I'm using it just on an old flannel cloth. And I'm going to be rubbing it into all of these marks. And these marks come from us trying to get these staples out. We've been using pliers and screwdrivers, and unfortunately, they dig into the wood during the process. And even though fabric's going to cover up most of these, some of them are going to stick out and they don't look very nice. So I picked this up on a whim, hoping it would help. And it does a really fantastic job. I'm incredibly impressed with it. So I thought I'd show you what a difference it makes. And once I'm done with this, I'm going to go ahead and wax everything. I've already waxed the large couch and it looks really nice and shiny. And we have officially taken all of these staples out of everything, which I am thrilled about. My dad did a bunch of them, which I really appreciate. So tomorrow we can reupholster everything, and hopefully that will be easier than the unupholstering of things, because that was much more difficult than I'd expected. I just have a little bit on the cloth. And then I'm going to rub it in. And there you go. So I think that looks way better. And now I'm going to go ahead and fill any other little marks that are on this. And then do the waxing, and I will be done for tonight. So it is day two of the couch building project. As I showed you guys last night, we got all of these staples out. So they're all stripped down to their original form, except for the plywood addition that we figure is probably added in the 80s at some point. I also did a little bit of research last night and learned that horsehair was sometimes used as an outer fabric for couches, as well as in the stuffing process. At least it was somewhat common in the 1800s. So this is probably actually Victorian, which is really cool. However, I'm not a big fan of the horsehair look, so I am going to still recover it with velvet like I originally planned. I have some quilt batting over here to soften the backing, since horsehair isn't the most comfortable, at least not after 150 years. And I also have the velvet, which I'm going to be using to cover it. There's also the foam over there, which I just vacuumed, and I am going to be reusing the foam because it doesn't smell bad and it doesn't seem to have a lot of dust in it when I shake it out, which makes me think it's okay. It's also really, really comfortable, so I'd hate to throw it away and potentially do something that isn't as nice. Other than that, I have pins and a measuring tape, and there's a staple gun and a compressor over there somewhere. I also have buttons, which I'm going to cover with velvet and use to replace the ones that were originally there. And then I have normal thread and upholstery thread to aid in this process. The original buttons they used on this were actually really cool. They have these big spikes that would go through the material and secure them in place and cause the tufted effect, but this really butchered the stuffing and it's really badly deteriorating in the back. So I think instead of using these, I'm going to secure the new buttons with thread and use upholstery thread for that, and hopefully that'll be a little bit less damaging to the interior. I'm not sure if it'll look as nice, but hopefully it will.
At this point, I was working solo and in specific areas, so I could film the process. Here I am stapling quilt batting onto the back panels to cover the straw. I tried to mark where I should be stapling with a marker, but ended up going more by feel as I got further into this project. I trimmed away the excess batting as I worked, then moved on to the front. And I used a pneumatic staple gun for this, so it's hooked up to an air compressor. This was great since I didn't have to press really hard on the wood to set the staples like you would with a typical staple gun. Now I'm laying my fabric over the batting and pinning it roughly in place. Then using my fingers to find divots where the buttons used to be, I threaded ribbon through these points until it came out the back, then threaded it back through the front of the couch fabric and tied it off at the front. This defined the divots really nicely and helped create the tufted effect before stapling the fabric in place. I did use pliers to help with this process since there were a lot of layers of material to get through. And the needle I used was a very, very large hand sewing one, so it was pretty sharp but had a big enough eye for the 1/8 of an inch ribbon. Then I stapled the material around the frame. I have more sympathy and respect for the people who originally covered this, and I definitely regret judging them so harshly. It's really difficult to get it to the edge of the wood. I tried to evenly disperse the fabric, then went back in and added more staples to get it to lay flat. And I tipped the couch over to do the bottom since that gave me more control. Also, we left the safety for the staple gun on since I was scared of stapling my hand to the couch. So I had to press down, then pull the trigger to get it to fire. Here I am working on the bottom. I really goofed up here. I thought like the tufted portion, the tighter pulled the fabric, the better. But since the foam on the bottom is much softer, that technique caused dimples along the front.
So this is the current state of things. I think this went pretty well, though I definitely made some mistakes. I think they're mistakes that I can correct when doing the next couple, so at least I learned from them. My major problem was putting these staples in too high because there's a ridge of wood here and a ridge of wood here, and it's difficult to feel when there's extra fabric coming down which ridge you're on. So a lot of these ended up going in really high and won't necessarily be covered by the trim. I'm thinking of doing two rows of this trim to help hide that, but we'll see. Around here I had a similar problem. A lot of these ended up going too far out, so it'll be sort of a challenge to cover up all of that with trim, but I will do my best. I do really like the color of it, and I think my trick for doing the tufting worked out well. As far as everything else goes, there are a few little points where I bunched the fabric because I didn't lay it out properly. You can see some here too. And there's also a little bit too much tension on the front, which is causing it to bubble a little bit. But other than that, I think it looks really good. I think I did a good job for my first attempt, and hopefully I will improve on the next couple. And hopefully I have enough fabric to do the next couple too, because I ended up discovering some marks on the piece that I cut for this. So I had to recut it, and I'm hoping I can use the piece with marks for some of the smaller sections, but we shall see. So now I'm going to hot glue all of the gimp trim on. It'd probably be more historically accurate to do this with tacks, but from what I've seen, hot gluing is an acceptable method, though I am open to hearing about other methods that I could use in the future. So that is the current plan.
Here is the couch with the trim added. I was way too generous with the hot glue on this one and ended up with a few smears on the fabric. But from a distance it looks nice, and I think conveniently placed throw pillows can save it. The process was repeated on the larger couch, except this one was harder since it was supposed to be symmetrical. Once again, I tried drawing lines where I needed to staple the batting, but I didn't follow them that closely. I did this for the front too, then laid the velvet on top and repeated my ribbon tufting technique. This was probably the most stressful part since I wanted them to be symmetrical, but I realized pretty quickly that having them independently look good was better than having them look kind of bad but even, and unfortunately those were my only two real options with my experience. Also, I thought stapling the tufted upper portions would be the most challenging part, but you're just pulling fabric taut over a shape that already exists, so it's sort of like draping a garment. I definitely struggled more with covering the cushion, since there needs to be more slack on that material. And while I staple away, please enjoy the soothing sounds of the air compressor. Now the same steps were repeated for the cushion, batting first, then velvet. I tried to leave more slack on the velvet this time, but that led to bunching at the bottom, so I actually think I did a worse job on this couch than the first one, which was really, really disappointing. These couches are so pretty, and I wish I could have done them justice with the upholstery, but sometimes you make mistakes, especially when you're learning and trying something new. So I'm not going to beat myself up over it too much, plus I could always recover them again if I was willing to spend another 15 hours removing staples. Now finally onto the chair, which was by far the easiest piece to do. Since it was smaller, I could manipulate it more and had more control over the positioning of the material, which was nice. I tried to film the tufting process here, but I'm not sure if it shows that well. And of course, there was more stapling. By this point, I found this part kind of fun. My fear of the staple gun had definitely faded, though I still kept the safety on.
Alright, so it is day 3 of this Victorian sofa project that has taken much longer than I expected. Yesterday I got a lot of the recovering done, and I also covered some waterberry buttons, which are really nice quality metal buttons, and I'm going to sew these over the tufted points, and hopefully it's going to look really good, because this is the plan that I'm depending on. Unfortunately, I don't have enough velvet left to cover the backs of the pieces, so I'm going to have to pick up a floral fabric that incorporates that pink and use that as the backing for all of them. But I'm not too bothered about that. I also need to get more hot glue to secure on the trim, and then I will have everything I need to finish this project. So hopefully I'll be able to get it tidied up today. So yeah, I'm going to sew some of these on and charge the camera because it's flashing at me, and then I will report back. So I successfully got all of the buttons sewn on, or in position depending on how you want to look at it. I was going to get it on camera, but I think to show you the method properly, I would have had to have a camera on both sides, and that just wasn't going to happen. But you can see how it looks from the front. front. I'm really pleased with it. So what I ended up doing was threading a very large needle through the back of the material up to the front where the original tufting was. Then I put the button on and threaded the ribbon and needle back through the back of the material, which is where I tied it off several times and trimmed the excess. I think this is pretty strong and I really like the effect. It was also very fast to do, which I appreciate since I've invested a lot of time into this project at this point. As you may notice, there isn't backing on this. I ended up using the velvet for the chair, and that didn't leave me with enough to back all of them with velvet. So I'm gonna try and find a matching or coordinating floral fabric online and order some of that, and then I can add backing to these at a later date. But I'm gonna try and get everything else finished, which means today I have to glue all of the trim onto this chair, as well as trim onto the larger couch. All right, so it's a couple hours later, and I've got all the trim on the couches, except for the back panels. Since I don't have enough fabric to cover those, I obviously can't add the trim. Overall, I'm unsure of how to feel about these. I think in some ways they turned out better than I'd expected and others worse. I definitely overestimated the amount of hot glue I needed in certain places, and that leads to certain bits looking quite ugly. There are also places where my staples weren't put in very evenly, so I had to add two rows of trim, and there are just some messy bits that I wish weren't that messy, but I'm pretty pleased with how they look from afar, and I really like the color, and I think for a first attempt I did a good job. I just wish I'd done an excellent job. So I'll probably put a little wrap up on the end of this video after I've edited all the footage and make sure to include any details I left out, but I think this is where I'm gonna leave it for today.
So this is my little squad of completed couches. I think I summed up my thoughts on this pretty well in the last clip. I wish I had done a better job, but I also think I did a decent job considering everything. They definitely look better than they did before. Though the staple removing part took way longer than I expected, as in it literally took 15 hours, I enjoyed the recovering process a lot, and I didn't have to do any refinishing work since the polish slash stain I purchased covered all the dents and scratches beautifully. Aside from some water damage at the back of the larger couch that I would need to sand down and restain. Maybe I'll take that project on someday when I have a little bit more experience with furniture. As far as tips go, I'm still far from an expert, but I say use a lot less hot glue than you expect and arrange twice, staple once. Most of my mistakes could have been avoided if I was a little more careful about laying out the fabric prior to stapling it. Also, buy more fabric than you think you'll need. Unless you have a pattern, the fabric needs to be cut larger than what you're covering and it goes fast. Also make sure to budget in tools. All I bought for this was the stain, polish, velvet, trim, and staples, which totaled around $85. But my dad was nice enough to lend me an assortment of pliers, screwdrivers, and other staple removing tools, along with the staple gun and compressor. Without those, this project would have been a much bigger investment. I think that covers everything. Isn't that a beautiful pun? Like recovering? I'm hilarious. If you enjoyed this video, then please let me know. Comments and likes really help me out, and make sure to check out the description box for more information. Thanks for watching, and I shall talk to all of you very soon.